بسم الله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وبعد. There is no end and limit to the benefits of good health. If a person has sound health, then he can engage and indulge in 1,000 activities. And if a person does not have sound health, then it can become an impediment and an obstacle to 1,000 things in life. A healthy person can be running, he can climb up a flight of stairs, it's easy for him to do his hajj, he can run and assist somebody, he could rescue someone, he could do so many things. In a like manner, when a person has strong faith, and may Allah bless us all with strong faith, Ameen Ya Rabbal Alameen, then the benefit of that strong faith will filter through in every aspect of his life, religious or otherwise. So a person with strong faith can observe fast in heat, he can stand in prayer, he can do so many good activities. Why? Because his faith is strong. But the benefit of that faith is even reaches out beyond religious scope. And what I intend speaking about is that often today a person has to go for some form of medical procedure, he needs to go for surgery. And there's scientific data as well to support this, that people with faith and people without faith, if they go through the same procedure, the recovery of a person with faith, okay, in the context of the scientific data, it's just faith, but we're speaking from a context of iman and belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the recovery of a person who has strength and faith in a divine being is much more swift and rapid versus a person who does not believe in any divine being. In the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not promise us that by virtue of iman, He will not test us. But rather Allah promises us, He'll give us strength in our test. So sometimes a person says that, but you know, I'm obeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I've done whatever I ought to do, why is it that I'm tested? Well, Allah says in the 13 Juz, يُثَبِّتُ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا بِالْقَوْلِ الثَّابِتِ فِي الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا وَفِي الْآخِرَةِ, that Allah will keep the believers firm. So often you're going through a challenge, and if it was another person without faith, he could be suicidal. He could resort to some drastic measures. But it is your faith that is keeping you sane. And I take you back to a very rich narrative and tale of Urwa bin Zubair rahimahullah. So he was a great tabi'i. He was the son of Zubair ibn al-Awam radiyallahu anhu, and the brother of Abdullah bin Zubair radiyallahu anhu. Urwa bin Zubair rahimahullah, he had once visited Damascus back in that time when Sulaiman ibn Abdul Malik was in the seat of power. And Sulaiman ibn Abdul Malik had invited him, labba da'wata, he acceded to the request of the ruler of the time. But when he got there, he encountered some challenges. His son was with him, and his son was having a look at some of the horses of the king. And one of the horses of the king gave him a kick and a blow, and it proved to be fatal, and it claimed the life of this boy. And obviously this was quite sad, because he came with joy, happiness and excitement, and it turned out to be quite challenging and difficult. Anyway, the boy was then lowered into the grave, and as the father lowered his own son into the grave, lo and behold, he injured his foot. So it got quite severe and intense. When he came out of the grave, it started swelling, and the doctors and the physicians of the time were called forward to try and rescue him and assist him. But after much medical deliberation, they agreed that the only way is to amputate his leg. Now, let's understand, in that time, you're not taken into theater, you're not sedated, you don't have all these advantages, local anesthetic or otherwise. But according to that time, they would give you, you know, a tot of alcohol just to make you relax you. So they said to him that we're going to give you something just to relax you so that you're calm, you're not anxious. This is surgery taking place. Understand, this is surgery taking place. And that's why I said the benefit of iman is far reaching. It benefits you, it empowers you in all aspects of your life. So they said, can we just, you know, give you something to just relax you and calm you? So he said, hayhat, no, not at all. I will not take any form of alcohol, even if it is at this situation. So they said, okay, then we're going to hold you down, and we need to, you know, keep you firm, because as they will sever your leg and they're going to amputate it, you will potentially move, and that might upset the procedure of the surgeon according to the time. So he said, أَكْفِيكُمْ بِالذِّكْرِ وَالتَّسْبِيحِ. I will engage in dhikr and tasbih, and you do what you have to do. And subhanallah, he started reciting dua. And for us, it might sound far-fetched. It might sound far-fetched that somebody engaging in dua and can get so consumed and overwhelmed and be in that state of proximity and enjoying and deriving pleasure, that in the process, his leg is amputated and he contains himself. You know, my brother mentioned a very amazing thing the other day. He says that today we find a young child, he's on a phone or a device. He is oblivious of what's happening around him. You can probably come in the room, you can take his wallet away, you can take another device away from him. He is unaware of who entered the room, who exited from the room. His dad has called out to him, his mom has called out to him. He heard nothing, he observed nothing. Why he's so immersed, consumed and overwhelmed. So these people had that level of pleasure in the dhikr and the adhkar. And while he engaged in dhikr and adhkar, then his leg was amputated. Now this was a medical procedure, but look at the strength of iman. Look at the strength of iman. Now we know in Islam the teachings are that whenever we clip our nails or trim our hair, then we bury it, just like when a person passes away. We believe the preservation of human dignity is in burying the body part, limb, organ, or the entire human as such. وَلَقَدْ كَرَّمْنَا بَنِي آدَمَ وَحَمَلْنَاهُمْ فِي الْبَرِّ وَالْبَحْرِ. We've dignified man, we've honored man. And part of the preservation of the dignity of man is that any organ, limb of his body, in fact, like I mentioned, the clipping of nails, we bury that as well. So they took his leg to bury it now because it was amputated. Wow, look at these words. My word. This is just beyond me. He said, before you bury my leg, bring it here. So the leg was brought to him, his own leg, which was now severed from his body. And then he gently strokes it. He gently strokes it. And he says, وَالَّذِي حَمَلَنِي عَلَيْكِ فِي عَتَمَاتِ اللَّيْلِ إِلَى الْمَسَاجِدِ يَعْلَمُ أَنَّنِي مَا مَشَيْتُ بِكِ إِلَىٰ حَرَامٍ قَطُّ. Allahu Akbar. For the record, O my leg, as you part ways with me, and hopefully we will be reunited in Jannah, I'm happy to say that we part ways on a note that Allah knows for the time He afforded me for you to be part of my anatomy and part of my body. I had never rested my weight on you and inched or walked towards anything forbidden in my entire life. Allahu Akbar. And then he sang the famous couplets of Ma'an bin Aws. لَعَمْرُكَ مَا أَهْوَيْتُ كَفِّي لِرِيبَ وَلَا حَمَلَتْنِي نَحْوَ فَاحِشَةٍ رِجْلِي وَلَا قَادَنِي سَمْعِي وَلَا بَصَرِي لَهَا وَلَا دَلَّنِي عَقْلِي وَلَا رَأْيِي عَلَيْهَا وَأَعْلَمُ أَنِّي لَمْ تُصِبْنِي مُصِيبَةٌ مِّنَ الدَّهْرِ إِلَّا قَدْ أَصَابَتْ فَتًا قَبْلِي. This is a person coming out of surgery. We need him to be sedated. He's got this painkiller, that painkiller. At the moment, for 3 days, just going to keep him under sedation, keep him under intensive care, just monitoring everything else, observing. This was surgery that was done. His leg was amputated. It was the strength of iman that kept him going. He said, it's just not my leg. لَعَمْرُكَ مَا أَهْوَيْتُ كَفِّي لِرِيبَ. I have not stretched my hand towards anything doubtful. وَلَا حَمَلَتْنِي نَحْوَ فَاحِشَةٍ رِجْلِي. And my leg never walked towards anything immoral or anything indecent. وَلَا دَلَّنِي عَقْلِي وَلَا رَأْيِي عَلَيْهَا. Neither have my gaze seen anything immoral or promiscuous, nor has my ears heard anything vulgar or obscene. وَلَا دَلَّنِي عَقْلِي وَلَا رَأْيِي عَلَيْهَا وَأَعْلَمُ أَنِّي لَمْ تُصِبْنِي مُصِيبَةٌ مِّنَ الدَّهْرِ إِلَّا قَدْ أَصَابَتْ فَتًا قَبْلِي. And I take solace from the fact that if Allah has tested me today, surely others have been tested and afflicted with greater challenges. So strong, so resilient, so motivating, it is only iman. Yesterday I went to visit a sister and I asked you to pray for her recovery. She's been diagnosed with an advanced level of cancer and doctors have predicted a short period of time. But I said to the sister that you keep your hopes high and we pray. Wallah, this sister's strength and resilience produced to my eyes a young sister in the prime of her life, and this is what has happened, and now they've given her a short period of time, and she's made total peace with the situation. Doctors have said in X amount of weeks, but when you meet her, greet her, and the family had called me in to give some encouragement and motivation, but I took motivation from her. This is Iman, and this is the strength of Iman. If there's anything we need to build and improve on our faith, it will give us strength in worship, and it will empower us in all aspects of life.